I spoke with comic and actor Aziz Ansari in 2010 when he was co-starring in the NBC series Parks and Recreation. In 2009, he was in the Judd Apatow film Funny People. Ansari's parents are from India, but he grew up in South Carolina and was the only person in his school who wasn't white. We started our interview with an excerpt of his Comedy Central stand-up special called Intimate Moments for a Sensual Evening, which had just come out on DVD and CD.
I like living in L.A. One thing I don't like about living here is driving. I always get bored when I'm driving. And when I get bored, I go on the internet on my BlackBerry. So I'm gonna die. And whenever they go through the records, they'll find my phone and be like, whoa, that's what he looked up right before he died? I'm gonna be so sad. I'll be like, comedian Aziz Ansari was killed in a car accident today. He was struck by another vehicle while using IMDb to see if Val Kilmer was indeed in the film Willow. Representatives for Mr. Kilmer confirm he was indeed in the film and hopes this will prevent future tragedies of this nature. This is the third Willow-related death this year. Comedian Aziz Ansari was killed in a car accident today. He was struck by another vehicle while checking showtimes for Up on Fandango. He just purchased a single ticket for a 4 o'clock show at a $2 theater in order to live out the saddest afternoon of all time. Comedy bad boy Aziz Ansari, aka comedy heartthrob Aziz Ansari, was killed in an awful automobile accident today. He was struck by another vehicle while Googling his own name.
That's Aziz Ansari from his comedy special, which is now on DVD, called Intimate Moments for a Sensual Evening. Aziz Ansari, welcome back to Fresh Air. That is really funny. What made you think about how embarrassing it would be to die while Googling yourself?
Well, I remember when I used to come out to L.A. for months at a time when we were doing this sketch comedy show I was on called Human Giant, and I didn't have GPS or anything, and I would be in rental cars, and I would be on my BlackBerry looking at maps at, like, the dumbest stuff, like using the Wendy's restaurant locator and things like that, and I was like, this is so dumb. I'm gonna die because I'm on my phone looking for a Wendy's. And so from that notion, I kind of came up with the other bits for that joke.
So I want to play another example from your show. That's now out on DVD and CD. And in this part, you're talking about watching a reality show on MTV called Next. It's a reality show about dating that I've actually never seen or heard of. But you had previously done a sketch comedy show as part of the group Human Giant on MTV. So
yes.
Here's your take on this dating reality show.
First guy that comes out, right? He's a guy going out on the dates. And he comes up there and he says this. He goes, yo, this girl better be pretty, because if she's a pain in the ass, I'm going to need something cute to look at. And I was stunned that he could say that. That's so offensive. And at the same time, on my show, they didn't want us to say that a character was raped by a dinosaur. Raped by a dinosaur, because that's too offensive. Oh, I guess I didn't want all these angry letters from paleontologists. We're like, hey, man, there's nothing in the fossil records to suggest that kind of behavior. So why don't you chill with your accusations? And then after you meet this dude, then you meet the girls he's going out on the dates with. And they come up there and they say things like, if he has a neck tattoo, I'm going to lick it. It's like, whoa, how slutty can you be in 5 seconds? And then after they say that, they freeze. And like three facts about them pop up on the left side. And the first two facts are always really normal. But the third fact always comes way out of left field. It's always like, Monica's 22. She's a hairdresser in Hollywood. And she hates purple gift wrap. Like, how does that define her as a person? And the whole show just bummed me out, man. Because the things they try to keep off TV are just like really explicit. Sex or violence, and no one cares about their kids seeing attitudes like that on TV, and that's way worse to me. Like, I'd much rather have a daughter that grew up and shot me in the leg and burned my house down than some really slutty girl that hates the sound of people eating bananas.
Are you amazed at how proud people are to behave stupidly on reality TV shows?
Man, every time I've seen that show Next, yeah, you really can't believe how terrible the people are that go on that show. What if each time you came back from a clip, I was just sitting here just laughing so hard at my own stuff? Oh, God, Terry, we got to take a break. I forgot about that bit. It's so funny. And you're like, oh, my God, this guy's really full of himself.
So do you feel like you had to create a personality, like a persona for yourself on stage, like a stage version of Aziz Ansari?
No, not really. I never made a conscious effort to do that. I just kind of tried to be kind of natural and conversational, and I think my stuff is kind of a little bit longer, more story-based. It's not as jokey sometimes, you know? So, yeah, I just try to create, like, a vibe of, you know, someone kind of casually telling you stories and things like that.
Now, you did create an alter ego comedian named Randy, which you portrayed in Funny People, and there's some really funny, you can find these on YouTube, really fun, funny video.
Wait, you're not going to play any excerpts from the
Randy?
Oh, they're
so filthy. There's like absolutely no word I could probably play on the radio.
Wait, can you say tatties? That's not even a real world. That's a word that Randy made up, tatties.
Right.
You can say tat. Let's just both say tatty. Terry, can you just say tatties real quick just to do it?
Oh, no, I would never say that word.
But that's not a real word.
I know.
Randy made up that word.
I know.
You could say it.
You're gonna make
it would be a landmark moment for NPR if you just said tatties one time. It's not a real word. They don't have to bleep it. It's an imaginary word.
Put it in a sentence for me.
Look at those tatties. They gotta let this on, please. They're definitely not gonna put any of it on NPR.
Okay, imaginary scenario. 4-year-old says to his mother, "Mommy, what's a tatty?"
And she'll be like, "I don't know. Is that something you heard on NPR?"
Then it must mean an intellectual endeavor involving...
Tatties refers to a rare form of violin playing that was practiced in ancient Denmark.
Thank you. Tatties, that's among my favorite type of music.
You said tatties.
You
did
go.
It. You did.
So tell us how you created your alter ego, Randy, for, like, who is Randy?
So Randy was a character in the film Funny People that was the last film Judd Apatow did, and he had this character, and there's very little bit of stuff written
it's
for
a,
Randy.
It's a film about stand-up comics, and you play
yes.
one of them. You know, who's...
Yes, and Randy was a small character, and the idea Judd kind of pitched to me was that he wanted the guy to be, like, really cocky and, like, very concerned about things like merchandising and things like that. So that was kind of the basic idea. And the other notion in my head all the time was, like, okay, you know, every time I've done comedy in, like, traditional comedy clubs, there's always these comedians that do really well with audiences but that the other comedians hate because they're just, you know, doing kind of cheapy stuff, like dancing around or doing like very kind of base sex humor a lot and stuff like that. So I kind of took that idea and ran with that as well.
And it's great. His DJ is called Ol Youngun. I love.
Yeah, that's this guy Brandon Johnson, who's very funny. I was at the UCB Theater in LA. It's a theater I perform in, and I was kind of workshopping the Randy material. And one night I had this idea of like, oh, well, Randy should have a DJ. And so I loaded up my laptop with like these sounds, like a lot of DJs and hip hop artists, when you see them perform live, they will have this reggaeton horn sample that just goes bah, 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 and rap artists use it like to death. And it's just like anytime you go see a rap show, they like hit that thing way too much. Like they'll just be like, "You guys psyched to be here tonight?" Bah, 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 bah. So I was like, well, what if a comedian used that sound too, the same way rappers do? So I wrote it that, and I recorded myself just going, "Randy!" Just like that. And so, like, my idea was, like, whenever I would do a joke at the end, it would just be like, and then I was like, "I gotta get out of here! Randy!" And, you know, so that was the idea. And I was just gonna keep the laptop on the side of the stage, and then after I finished a joke, like jump over and just start hitting those buttons like crazy. So like I would finish a joke, and there'd be like ran, 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 dee, 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 you know, like that. And my friend Brandon was there, and I was like, "Oh, Brandon's really funny. What if he's just the DJ?" And so he did it, and like right away, I could tell he was just gonna be awesome at this. And so every time I did Randy after that, he was there.
So we're gonna squeeze in one more clip here.
Sure.
Here's another clip from Aziz Ansari's Comedy Central special that's now out on DVD and CD. And this is something that is in part talking about movies. I don't think I really need to set it up, though.
I was doing an interview once, and this guy goes, you must be pretty psyched by all this Slumdog Millionaire stuff. And I was like, yeah, I am. I have no idea why, though. I had nothing to do with that movie. It's just some people that kind of look like me are in this movie that everyone loves and winning Oscars and stuff. And I was like, whoa. Are white people just psyched all the time? It's like, Back to the Future, that's us. Godfather, that's us. Godfather Part 2, that's us. Departed, that's us. Sunset Boulevard, that's us. Citizen Kane, that's us. Jaws, that's us. Every movie but Slumdog Millionaire and Boys in the Hood is us.
So is that a good summation of what you think of, like, identity politics?
When I crafted that joke, I wasn't doing it in the idea of, like, what is my, statement on identity politics, but I think that is really how I felt. Like, I don't think that guy, when he asked that question, was being racist or anything when he said, are you psyched about Slumdog Millionaire? Because the answer is yes, and it's actually very interesting to me, like, why are people psyched about that? Why do I get psyched that movie's doing well? I had nothing to do with it. Why is there that kind of sense of, like, camaraderie with people that are just happen to be of the same ethnicity as me? And then, you know, then from that I took the idea of, like, well, I mean, what I'm really saying is, oh, so I guess white people don't have that because they're so everywhere and so successful. I guess the reason you do get excited is because, oh, you don't really see a lot of Indian people doing Oscar-winning movies. So when you see that, you feel kind of proud, I guess. But, you know, so if that was true for white people, they'd be psyched all the time because every movie has white people in it, you know.
Honey, do you want butter beans or lima beans? Are you building a coffin?
Yep. One for me and one for you.
Hank, why doesn't the lid on mine close all the way?
It does. I mean, it almost closes. I'll make sure it closes come the big day.
That's a scene from the animated series King of the Hill, featuring the co-creator of the show, Mike Judge, as Hank Hill. Judge created the MTV animated series Beavis and Butthead and did the voices of the title characters. And he wrote and directed the film comedies Office Space, Idiocracy, and Extract. I spoke to Mike Judge in August 2009, just a few weeks before King of the Hill aired the last episode in its 13th and final season. Would you describe Hank Hill and his family?
Hank he sells propane and propane accessories, and he's got his house and his family, and he's kind of has this way that he thinks the world ought to be that's maybe he belongs in the 50s or something like that. And, you know, he's just up against all the ridiculous things that the modern world brings.
He lives in a suburb. He's the kind of guy who goes to Home Depot and drinks beer with his friends. He's probably politically conservative. At the same time, he's very open-minded and often does things that would go against whatever ideology he would seem to profess. And he wants to always do the right thing by individuals, whether or not that coincides with what his, like, larger ideological belief might be. Now, you do the voice of Hank.
Yes.
I want to play a scene from a recent episode. And you do two regular voices in the series, Hank and his friend Boomhauer. And Boomhauer has this kind of, like, postmodern mumble.
<that's> yeah.
Really hard to make like sense that. Of what he's saying. So Boomhauer has just swapped homes with a Canadian couple, so he's about to leave for Canada for 3 months.
Oh, yeah.
So here's Hank and Boomhauer, and I think a couple of friends are with them there, too.
This will no doubt be the best summer of our entire lives.
Yep.
Well, I tell you what, man, I'd love to just chill back and then get a dang old grill and chill, man, but I'm about to head up Canada this summer, man. Canada? A man only has so many summers, Boomhauer. Why would you waste yours in a country that's dismantling its navy?
Talking about them house swapping in no Canadian family for
House swap? There's gonna be Canadians living here, walking around, touching things for 3 whole months?
You're going to be gone for an absurd amount of time. What if we all make new friends or get remarried? It could happen. Love is funny.
And that's a scene from a recent episode of King of the Hill with my guest, the creator of the series, Mike Judge, as Hank Hill and as his friend Boomhauer. So, you know, as I'm talking to you, I'm listening for the sounds of Hank Hill in your voice. And I hear it, but also what you're doing for Hank Hill, though, is different. There's much more of a southern twang to it. Can you talk about creating the voice for Hank?
Well, you know, I had a paper out when I was a kid in Albuquerque, New Mexico. And on my paper out, there was a guy. It was the first time my brother and I shared this paper out. And we'd go collect at the end of every month. And this guy was always out on his front lawn drinking a beer. And we came to collect. And this is our first time collecting. And this guy looks at us and is kind of staring at us. We said, "Hi, we're collecting for the Albuquerque News." And he says, "Well, you ain't my paper boy." And said, "Well, I know, but your paper boy quit, and we're the new paper boys." "Well, I know what my paper boy looks like, and you ain't my paper boy." And said, "Well, yeah, he's gone, and you know." And then he brings his wife over and says, "Is he the paper boy?" "No." This went on. We said, "Well, we're going to have to cancel the paper then." He said, "Oh, I'm going to get the paper when the real paper boy comes." And so we just kept delivering, and we'd skip his house, and he'd be out there drinking his beer, kind of eyeballing us. And finally, he swallowed his pride after like 4 months, and he called in a subscription. And I mean, there was also when the first time my ex-wife and I, we bought a house in outside of Dallas, and there'd be these guys out there drinking their beers in the alley, and you know, like I was, the storm had like blown off, just knocked loose a little part of my fence. So I went out there and I was, you know, I got a hammer and I'm just thinking, okay, I'll just nail this thing back there. And I see this guy over kind of eyeballing me, looking at what I'm doing. And then he comes over, followed by a couple others, and he says, "Well, you're going to have to take the whole section out. And this post here is a little rotted." And then before I know it, one of them brings over a wheelbarrow. They yanked out the whole thing. They're digging up a fence post. They're pouring concrete. They're mixing concrete. And finally, I kind of became kind of useless. I went back inside, and my wife at the time, like, you know, we hadn't even eaten breakfast, and we're looking out the window, and she goes, "What's going on?" And I said, "Oh, they're building me a fence, I guess." And then I went back out there. Finally, they got the post set, and they did the string across, whatever, and he's saying, you know, "You got to leave a 1-inch gap, otherwise them termites are going to get on your palings." And so he tells me how to do it. I start putting on the palings. This is much, you know, like 3 or 4 hours later. I'm hammering the nails in. I see him over, and he peeks his head out of the alley. He's looking at me, and he walks over, and I'm going, "Oh, God, what now?" And he comes over and says, "Those are the wrong kind of nails. You're going to need galvanized steel. Here, I'll go get you some." And anyway, I just thought this would be like a funny kind of world, because they really were good neighbors. I mean, they were nice people, and they were helpful. And it's kind of like what you're saying about, I don't even know what their politics were. I don't even care. I don't know what, I think people who analyze shows like this probably tend to put too much of politics on it, because I don't think people like this, including myself, don't wake up and think about politics all day. You've got work to do and this kind of stuff. And so, I think it's just kind of like about neighbors who, you know, and like you say, ultimately do the right thing and do right by people and are basically good people.
So for anybody who missed Beavis and Butthead when it was on, describe the two characters.
Well, they're also kind of hard to describe, but they're just, you know, basically kind of inane, dumb 15-year-olds, and they would, it started out as it was going to be them just sitting on a couch watching music videos, not talking to camera, but talking to each other, and then we started doing these little mini episodes, well, from the get-go, and yeah, they, They became the scapegoat of bad television or something for a while there.
Well, let's hear a scene, and we'll get to hear what their kind of mumbly voices are like and their famous laughs. So here's a scene. It's Halloween. It's Halloween night, and they're watching TV.
Isn't this the same place that those other kids got killed 2 years ago?
Don't be crazy, Tina. You act like you don't even want to get it on.
That dude with the mask is messed up.
Yeah, really. He didn't even wait for that chick to take off her shirt.
Yeah. It's like, this could never happen in real life. Damn it, that's like the 10th time tonight or something.
Maybe we should see who it is.
Oh, yeah.
Trick or treat.
Cool.
Who was that?
Just some dudes passing out free samples.
Cool. Free samples rule.
You take my kid's candy, and I kick your ass! Happy Halloween!
Ween.
That's a scene from Beavis and Butthead with my guest Mike Judge, the creator of the series, doing the voices of Beavis and Butthead. I love that. I mean, these characters, characters sit around watching TV condescending to watch what they're watching all day, and they're so stupid that they don't even know that it's Halloween and this is a trick-or-treat bag. They think it's free samples. Yeah. But it's like you've really captured in this condescension as a way of life, as just like a sport, just sitting around making fun of other people, not realizing quite how stupid you are yourself.
Yeah, well, I've known guys like this that just, you know, I remember this guy in college, just like fat schlub of a guy, and I was talking about, just like sitting on the couch, and I said, I was talking about somebody that my roommate knew, and I said, yeah, he just made the basketball team, you know, UC San Diego, and yeah, I was impressed. He just made the basketball team. This guy just sits there and he goes, basketball. You know, I'm thinking like, who the hell are you to say basketball? And so, it was always fun to have these guys who are just obviously complete losers and no one hangs out with them but each other. And yet,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.